Well done, well done. Oh, God. It'll be okay, because in a matter of time, the pretties will be all ours.
Yes.
And not Andy's.
And we will have lots of money. So we can move out of the basement, finally, and get our own place.
Finally. You hear something?
I think so. I think it's Mom. Here, put that up.
Boys, why is it so dark in here? Let me turn on the light.
Oh, Mom. We're trying to study.
Mom, I said I'd take out the trash later. Hey, Mom, while you're down here, can we borrow your car this weekend?
I don't know about this.
Just let me borrow your car.
Please?
Mom, you gonna let me borrow your car or what?
We'll fill it up with gas or something.
I guess.
Score! Ha! Let's go get Andy's pretties.
So, having arranged our call out and with a favourable weather forecast, we met our friends Richard and Clive early next morning. 4 is an ideal number for a caving party. Large enough to deal with emergencies, but small enough to be manageable and to make reasonable progress.
It's a bit chilly. Large sizes in them. So what, you've got thermals underneath?
Yes, I've got thermal underwear. I've got long wetsuit socks up to here.
Good.
Plastic oversuit.
Right, fine. Have you seen the modification I've got on my Wellington boots?
No.
What I've got here is a plastic ring. Just fits in the top of the well. It's just cut from an old plastic drum, riveted together. And it just fits neatly in the top. And then when I put my oversuit on, I've got an elastic band here just from an old inner tube. Pull the oversuit up, seal it round the top, and I can actually wade up to waist deep in water with only a very small amount leaking in. Mm-hmm. Joe, I just wanted to have a quick word with you about emergency kit.
Well, a lot of cavers do is they put all their kit together in a box like this. But it's not really very well designed for being anchored in a cave. It's a very bulky, square sort of object. And you get problems as well. If the party divides, if one group go on deeper into the cave and another group come back, then you have to decide who's going to take the box. And also, because it's not an easy object to carry, it tends to get left behind. So if the going gets difficult, people say, we'll just stick this in a corner and collect it later. So I think it's a much better idea if you have your own personal emergency kit, if you're completely self-reliant in terms of emergency equipment. And it really doesn't require a great deal of bulk. You don't have to carry anything particularly heavy. And you can see everything here that I carry with me is a matter of course. And most of it just fits into this little plastic bottle. So I'll just pop the stuff in now and you can see what I take. A couple of candles. Now these are not just a light source, but they're a heat source, which is very important in a survival situation. You can actually use those to keep yourself quite warm for several hours. So a couple of candles. I've got a bandage, sealed up in plastic. You can use it as a bandage, or we can make it into a pad for a wound dressing. So I'll pop that one. Spare bolts, and also just a couple of aspirins I like to take, just in case someone has a headache or something. Very easy thing to, very small item to pop in. So spare bolts, pops in too. We need to be able to light the candles, so I found the most effective one.
Just a chocolate bar for a bit of extra energy. Always useful.
Right, okay. I think we're ready to go.
Finally! God! All right, let's go. Let's go.
I'm so British.
All right, let's go.
Caves are all owned by somebody, and permission to descend must often be sought. This may involve simply making a courtesy call on a local farmer. In other cases, access is more difficult, and the cave may be gated and locked. Guidebooks include access information, but this is liable to change at short notice.
There's actually a boulder blockage straight on ahead. Do you want to go on up the slope,
right,
Clive? Now, I'm going to be careful here on these boulder slopes because you never know how stable they are. And it's as well to... You don't want to be right below someone when something like that comes off. Is that all right up there now, Clyde?
It's a bit better here.
Okay, but if we... Oh yeah, that's right. So just hang on a sec while I get out of the way. It's still a bit loose here. If you do get a serious situation where someone is dangerously cold to the point of being seriously exposed or even hypothermic, or if you yourself were trapped in a cave, perhaps by a rockfall or by flooding, then you'd have to have some way of providing extra insulation. And we can do that by using some of the bits and pieces in my plastic emergency box and by using a lightweight survival bag. So I'm going to take this one out and we'll actually have a go and we'll use it to provide a sort of heat tent. So just you have to unfold these very, very carefully. You can see it's very, very thin and you have to be extremely careful as you actually unroll it or you can damage it while you're doing this. So what we can do is we find the open end here. We can use it like a sort of sleeping bag. Just open it up, climb right inside it, and then draw it up like a shawl around the face. Mm-hmm. And that's one simple way of using it. But there is a better, rather clever and more effective way of using it, which involves turning the whole thing around. So now we've got the sealed end. What we have to do now, this is where a knife is a useful thing to have. If you stand right up on... Okay, so what we now want is something insulated for you to sit on.
Actually, it feels a lot warmer already.
Well, you're going to put the bag right over your waist. Take your helmet off first.
Right.
Yeah.